I want to thank you for your interest in Higher Ground's webinar series. This webcast today is very powerful and educational. It is my pleasure to introduce to you our guest speaker, Nathan Lee, the president of the Denise Amber Lee Foundation. All right, Nathan, take it away.
Thank you very much, Jake. I really appreciate the intro. Hello, everyone. Like Jake said, my name is Nathan Lee, and I want to thank Higher Ground for this opportunity to tell you about the Denise Amber Lee Foundation and its successes, its goals, and its history. I started the foundation in 2008 after my wife was kidnapped, raped, and murdered.
Welcome.
There were 5 calls made to 911 that horrific day, but all failed to keep her killer from committing his evilness. I want to make it clear from the outset that it is not my intent in any way to vilify an industry that failed her that day. In our eyes, you truly are the country's first line of defense of our homeland security. As many of you know, Denise's case is a painful reminder that the first person to take a young mother's call for help cannot be the weakest link of the chain. As we have traveled across the country the last 2 years speaking at 911 conferences, we haven't met a more compassionate, dedicated group of people than those in the 911 industry. We have a short 9-minute video that we will show here in a moment that highlights the details of our case. The Denise Amber Lee Foundation is determined to do whatever we can to raise public awareness of the challenges you face every day. And we are determined to do whatever we can so that no other family has to endure the pure hell we have endured the last couple of years without. We feel our mission is to promote and support public safety through uniform training, standardized protocols, defined measurable outcomes, and technological advances in the 911 system. What I hope to do here today is to challenge your way of thinking about the best way of bringing changes and improvements to the 911 system. At the end of our presentation today, we will be happy to take any questions you might have. So now, let's see if we can take a look at this short video to give those of you not familiar with our tragedy some background on our beginnings.
Ready, Daddy?
I'm ready. You ready?
Denise Amber Lee, a devoted wife and loving mother.
Oh my goodness.
Her husband Nate working 3 jobs to make ends meet. They'd rented a house in Northport, Florida, a perfect safe haven for their growing family, or so they thought. January 17th, Nate came home from work to find his 2 young sons lying together in a crib, but Denise nowhere to be found.
Had you ever known her to leave the children alone?
No.
So when do you start to freak?
I started freaking about then.
Nate called his father-in-law, Rick Goff, a 25-year veteran of the Sheriff's Department in neighboring Charlotte County.
He was like, Denise is missing. And I'm like, going, what? You got to explain what you mean by that. And he says, I'm telling you, she's missing. She's not in the house.
It would turn out she'd been kidnapped by a stranger. The suspect spotted in the driveway by a neighbor, a paunchy guy in an old green Camaro. Not long after, a stomach-churning 911 call from Denise herself, who'd managed to sneak her abductor's cell phone away from him while he was driving.
First thing was her screaming.
Does it get more awful than that to hear?
You know, she's answering the 911 operator's questions by laying on the phone listening to it.
Giving some sort of a description of the guy?
Yeah, that she's making it sound like she's talking to him. I mean, she was really smart. He never knew it until like 7 minutes into the call, and he finally figured his phone wasn't there, and he searched and found it missing.
That call ended before police were able to locate Denise. Then, 16 minutes later, another call came in. This one routed to the Charlotte County Sheriff's Office where her father worked.
I'm on 41 going south, and I was at a stoplight, and a man pulled up next to me, and there was a child screaming in the car.
It came from a driver, Jane Kowalski, witnessing Denise's abduction in real time, thinking it was a child banging on the window in the back.
He's going slower than I am, which is not right. Something's going on. Oh. He just turned on Toledo Bright. I don't know if I can catch up. There's a bunch of traffic and I can't get over.
Kowalski can't make the turn. She goes straight. She's lost him. But it's what happened next that would cause a firestorm of controversy.
We blew it. And I say we because I'm part of that sheriff's office.
No one would ever pick up the chase where Jane left off. Hundreds of law enforcement officers in three counties, even a helicopter above. But none would ever follow that green Camaro and its screaming captive down Toledo Blade. Why? Because no one ever got the message. The 911 dispatchers had forgotten to send it out. 7 hours after Denise's ordeal began, the authorities arrested the suspected kidnapper, Michael King. But his victim, the young wife and mother, was still missing. Until 2 days later, when her body was recovered from a wooded area, just 6 miles from where she'd been last seen by that eyewitness driver. So many people would ask later, could she have been saved if the 911 dispatchers had kept their cool? It didn't help the sheriff's case that at the time the 911 call came in, there was an officer parked on the side of the very road King had turned onto when Kowalski lost him.
Well, one dispatcher thought the other had sent it out. The other thought she had, the other one had sent it out, and they didn't send it out.
We actually had a guy sitting on the same road that drove right by him. The deputy emailed me and says, listen, I hate to say this, but I was sitting on the road and I know the guy drove right by me, but I didn't have the information. The call was never dispatched, I wasn't given the information, and he drove right by me. And if I had known the information, because I've been in law enforcement over 20 years, I know I would have stopped that car.
I swear every time I hear the story, it seems like there's another cop car that was in the vicinity. I've heard one, I've heard two, I've heard five.
So they're blasting past units that could have stopped it right
yes.
then and there.
Yeah. There's not a doubt in my mind Denise would still be here. Not a doubt in my mind.
But the green Camaro would not be stopped until hours later. A police dragnet finally collars driver Michael King.
And then when I heard of the car being stopped on the interstate by the trooper, I was pretty excited.
But where is Denise? It's Friday, the day after a shocking kidnapping in Northport, Florida. A work day, but many businesses close and scores of people skip work, joining police in the search for Denise Lee. Inside kidnapped suspect Michael King's car, police turn up Muxlow's shovel. It's muddy now. And in the backseat, there is new evidence that even when she'd lost hope, Denise Lee was still trying to outsmart her captor, leaving clues just like her dad would have wanted.
I worked undercover 15 years, so I think some of that rubbed off on her. Plus, she liked to watch cop shows, believe it or not.
She pulled some of her hair out, strand by strand, leaving DNA behind.
She left clues. She wasn't going to let him get away with what he was going to get away with.
Denise also took from her finger a simple silver ring that could only be traced to her.
Nathan, I asked you to come in here because I need to ask you a couple questions as far as her jewelry.
Nathan, her husband, his father-in-law Rick Goff by his side, must face strong evidence that Denise is gone.
We have a piece of jewelry here that I want you to look at, okay? Well, you will be able to tell us if this is it or not. We're not sure, okay? Is this her ring?
Yes. It's the first ring I gave her for Valentine's Day.
How confident are you that's her ring?
100%.
It was a ring I gave her on her first Valentine's Day. She purposely left her ring in the back seat of his car. I know that for a fact because that ring never came off. It was tight on her finger.
And it was something that she knew if she left behind, you'd know it.
Yeah. It took me less than a second to confirm that it was hers.
Very sad news out of Northport. The search for a kidnapped woman has been suspended. Police called off the search after the remains of a woman were found near the intersection of I-75 and Toledo Blade Road.
We've recovered the remains of an unidentified white female buried.
Out of chances, less than 3 miles away from her home, Denise Lee was shot to death. Her body found here in a shallow grave along the side of this road. It showed signs of brutal rape.
Denise is thankful that all your efforts brought her home.
I'm going to miss her so much. I don't know how I'm going to go through the rest of my life without her.
Got a picture of you I carry in my heart. Close my eyes to see it when the world gets dark. Got a memory of you. I carry in my soul. I wrap it close around me when the nights get cold. And if you ask me how I'm doing, I'd say just fine. But the truth is, baby, if you could read my mind, not a day goes by that I don't think of you. After all this time, you're still with me, it's true. Somehow you remain locked so deep inside. Baby, baby, oh baby, not a day.
Mom is an essay. That's an angel.
He's an
Mom
angel?
Not a day goes
by. I always say, no matter how many times I view this video, it doesn't get any easier. And believe me, it doesn't. Never take life for granted, and never take that next call for granted. I imagine some of you are reacting to that video like many around the country have. It's disturbing and heartbreaking. The sheer senselessness and randomness of this crime and the unbelievable amount of missed opportunities has caught the attention of people all over the world. With the exception of Antarctica, of course, I think we have heard from people from every continent after this has happened. They were outraged that this killer wasn't stopped. There is no doubt in my mind that Denise should be home with our two little boys today, just like she was on the day she was kidnapped. But that is not the reality of the moment. Many of you who are familiar with John Walsh and the tragic story of his son Adam's abduction and murder, in his book, Tears of Rage, there's a paragraph that I felt I could have written myself. I would like to read it to you. Mr. Walsh writes, "People who haven't been hit by crime can still enjoy what my wife and I call the luxury of being naive. They go around thinking that it can never happen to them. I envy those people. I truly do. They don't understand that once it happens to you, everything changes. Every tiny aspect of your life. And even though you may look the same on the outside and may be acting the same way, on the inside, you're coming from a totally different place." He continues, "To us, even back in the early days, our most basic understanding was always unspoken. Adam cannot have died in vain. If we had not gone on to do what we eventually did, we would have remained as we were, two grief-stricken, hand-wringing parents who other people looked at and felt sorry for. But we both came to believe that if you're given the opportunity to change things, then how can you at least not try?" As you can see from this slide, our story has been featured on many national fronts. We feel our mission is to be the emotional spearhead to bring awareness to the challenges of this industry and be an example of the horrifying consequences that can occur from the limitations and inefficiencies of the current system. Having our pain on display time and time again is not enjoyable, but if it can be a catalyst for change, we will enthusiastically accept that role. We envision a partnership with 911 industry members, state and federal legislators, and responsible media to drive change to public policy. I'm here to tell you that public perception of this industry is very different than the reality, and it takes the public to urge their legislative representatives to enact laws for adequate funding and standardized procedures. I'm going to submit to you that a public outcry for improvements to the 911 system will happen at a far more rapid rate by publicizing and focusing on the mishaps and tragedies in this industry as opposed to the success stories of lives saved. I don't know how many of you saw the Dr. Phil show that I appeared on, and I know many of you cringed as you watched an hour of those painful stories. But if you looked at the message board on Dr. Phil's website, you would have seen that the show generated more comments than any other show aired during that 2 or 3 week time frame. The Dateline NBC episode featuring our tragedy was the number one story on Dateline's website for 6 weeks. That's what this industry needs. That's the kind of public reaction and outrage that will drive public policy for change. Embrace it. The stories of talented call takers and dispatchers who provide calming directions to help a father birth his son or daughter are heartwarming. These professionals need to be recognized and rewarded. But I wonder if these stories aren't counterproductive to raising public awareness of the challenges you face every day in keeping up with technology, limited funding, and the need of uniform, mandatory standards. If the public just sees these feel-good stories, they will feel no urgent need to approve an additional fee on their phone bills to improve a system that appears to have no problems. Let's look at some other evidence to prove this theory. When John Walsh's son Adam was abducted from a mall in 1981, he and his wife assumed that the FBI would come swooping in immediately to catch the bad guy and return their son. However, what they found out was shocking to them. The FBI could look for stolen automobiles, but was not authorized to look for stolen children. To their further amazement was the fact that there was no national database to keep track of the over 150,000 child abduction cases each year. The shocking reality of their story brought much-needed attention to this issue and was instrumental in the passage of the Missing Children's Act and the establishment of the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Many of you are familiar with the Eddie Pollock story in 1994. Eddie was the innocent victim of a group of teenagers bent on revenge. He was descended upon by a group of baseball bat-wielding youths in the Fox Chase section of Philadelphia and brutally beaten and murdered on the steps of St. Cecilia's Church. By all accounts, the 911 system failed miserably on the night of the attack, delaying police response to dozens of calls during the emergency from Fox Chase citizens in the 45 minutes leading up to the Fox Chase beating. Being a busy Friday night, the limited airwaves were clogging, and even though there were available police to respond, the dispatchers couldn't get the word out. As a result of this one incident, a complete overhaul of the Philadelphia 911 system had begun. Training for call takers and dispatchers is now 8 weeks, compared to just 5 days before the Pollock incident. The comm center was upgraded its CAD system. Patrol cars were given MTDs, and the Northeast Division was split into two radio bands to lighten on air traffic. Let me give you just a couple other examples where these tragedies energize society and policymakers in a positive way for change. In 1996, 9-year-old Amber Hegerman was abducted while riding her bicycle in Arlington, Texas. 4 days after her abduction, her body was found in a drainage ditch. Her parents, with the help of Mark Kloss, whose own daughter Polly had been abducted and murdered in 1993, soon established People Against Sex Offenders. The intense media coverage and public outrage this case generated forced Congress to draft the Amber Hegerman Child Protection Act, which was eventually signed into law in 1996 by President Clinton. Of course, this led to the very successful Amber Alert system that we are all familiar with today. And this last example, unfortunately, comes from my home state of Florida. Jessica Lunsford was a young girl in Florida who was raped and murdered by John Cooey, a convicted sex offender. Cooey lived just a few hundred yards from the Lunsford's home. Public outrage over this case spurred Florida officials to introduce and pass Jessica's Law. This is the informal name given to a law designed to punish sex offenders by imposing a mandatory minimum sentence of 25 years in prison and lifetime electronic monitoring. These are just a few of the many examples of the power of these tragic events. These are examples of where rapid change occurred as a result of the good people in our society rallying around the cause brought to their attention by the media coverage of a tragedy. These tragedies not only disgust you and me, they energize society and policymakers in a positive way for change. Let's look at what the Denise Amber Lee Foundation is trying to accomplish. Obviously, we are traveling the country and talking to anyone who will listen about Denise's tragedy and the need to stop these tragedies from happening. It seems the one common factor in many of these tragedies is a lack of adequate training for those answering the call and dispatching the call. You know, the air traffic control industry figured this one out years ago. When you board a plane in New York and fly to Los Angeles, you travel through many different distinct air traffic control zones. But because of uniform, standardized training and procedures, communication and passage from one zone to another is seamless. Yet in the 911 industry, a patchwork of technology, inconsistent training levels from one PSAP to another, and incompatible communications seems to be acceptable. In my wife's case, her killer drove through three jurisdictions before murdering her. The internal affairs investigation of that night showed one dispatcher, which actually was a supervisor, spending close to an hour trying to patch a radio connection into the neighboring jurisdiction. So we feel very strongly that the industry needs to identify a uniform training standard for all telecommunicators in the country, and they must show proficiency through passage of an exam for certification. And let me just add that all of this standardized training and certification is useless if it is not coupled with a strong quality assurance procedure. The greatest technology in the world is useless if personnel are not trained properly on its use. We have heard from many people in the industry that analysis of how calls are handled and dispatched only occur after a tragic outcome. I desperately plead with you not to allow an internal affairs investigation to be your quality assurance program. The reason we are doing this webinar today is because Higher Ground has a reputation for a strong, comprehensive, and user-friendly quality assurance program. Bad habits and tragedies will continue if supervisors do not institute an ongoing, automatic, random review of calls. Forward-thinking supervisors would recognize that this is a valuable opportunity for continuing education and training to correct errors before they result in a tragedy. Passage of a state-administered exam for certification seems to be elusive in the industry today, but from our perspective, essential. I hope I don't offend anyone with these next few slides, but how does it make you feel that you have lives on the line every time you take a call, but your job isn't deemed as critical of state oversight as barbers, nail technicians, dog groomers, and tattoo artists? Apparently, our state legislators feel that their constituents deserve to have their hair cut properly and their dogs groomed correctly, but don't deserve to have their frantic calls for help handled in a uniform, standardized manner by a trained, state-certified professional. Some crazy tattoos going on there. The last item of concern on this list is technology. I'm not going to talk about this today because I could go on all day. But suffice it to say, technology from one jurisdiction to the other has to be compatible to communicate rapidly back and forth. And the fact that we can't pinpoint the location of a cell phone calling 911 is unacceptable in my view. Next, I want to give you some details on the successful Florida training bill that was just signed into law. The more we travel to other states, the more we are impressed with Florida's bill. We were not the architects of this bill and have to give a ton of credit to those stakeholders in Florida who have been working on this for years. Florida APCO is particularly responsible for keeping this issue burning until Denise sacrificed her life and became collateral damage of a flawed system. We spoke before several committees as this bill moved through the legislature. And if we heard it once, we heard it 1,000 times. It's a shame it took something like this to get something done. But as you can see from this slide, Florida's law requires all agencies to train their call takers and dispatchers to a state-approved 232-hour curriculum. It then requires all call takers and dispatchers to pass a state-administered exam to become certified. It requires continuing education of 20 hours every 2 years. And it identifies a funding source by authorizing the state's E911 fund to pay for the training. Many of the states that we travel to have mandatory training statutes in place, but what we hear from the industry people is that, yes, it's there, but it's not enforced, and therefore it's not being done by everyone. We all know how difficult it is to retain personnel. If your state does not have a means of verifying training proficiency, it is responsible to assume that many agencies will keep incompetent telecommunicators to fill seats. And that is when tragedies will happen, leading to shattered lives, endless lawsuits and liability claims, and expensive payouts by the citizens of the state. From our perspective, any successful training legislation must contain these elements. You must identify a uniform standard that all telecommunicators in the state will complete. Many of you are training to these now. As we have traveled the country, we hear of the basic competencies that everyone agrees must be mastered. There are many established standards already identified. This should be the easy part to accomplish, and this is where many statutes stop. Don't let this be an unfunded mandate. Find and tap into a funding source. If you think the people of your state won't support funds for training, you are not thinking outside the box. If I knew Florida did not have mandatory training while Denise was alive, I sure would have given thousands to save her life. Maybe millions, I don't know how much her life was worth. You can't put a number on it. It is how you frame the argument and how you tap into the emotion of the citizens that will make the difference. Identify a state oversight agency for making sure that all telecommunicators are proficient in the uniform standard. I know 911 has always been a locally controlled service, but times have changed where America is a very mobile society, and we now have the mobile phones for communication. A 911 call in Miami should be handled the same as a 911 call in Tampa. The citizens of any state deserve and expect consistent levels of service, and this can only happen with a stronger state oversight. This oversight conceivably will allow states to achieve a consistent level of service and potential for an interoperable system instead of an unacceptable patchwork of agencies, protocols, and technologies cobbled together to respond to 911 calls. Training legislation must have a hard and fast date for compliance. Wording that says all call takers and dispatchers must or shall complete 40 hours of training is too ambitious. It just says that someday they need to be trained. Hopefully not after someone loses their life. It needs to be specific as to when this training must be completed and impose penalties if not. And the last one here can't be overlooked. Don't just look for any sponsor. Look for a strong, effective, experienced sponsor. And you need a sponsor in both houses of your legislature filing, and gathering support and co-sponsors for the bill in each house. Filing one bill is only one side of the legislature, narrows your chances of success. All right, I am off my soapbox. I want to thank all of you for listening, and we cannot continue to spread the word on the challenges you face every day without your support. If you think we are on the right track and want to send a donation, please send it to our PO box. I want to thank everyone at Higher Ground for this amazing opportunity and urge all of you to explore their excellent product line. And I'm now available to answer any questions you may have.
Nathan, excuse me, I can't thank you enough for sharing your heart-wrenching story with us, and we certainly applaud your efforts to form a foundation and raise awareness for improved dispatcher training. I really appreciate it.
I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you very much, Jake.
Sure. At this time, we're going to be joined by Mark Lee. He's the vice president of Denise Amber Lee Foundation. And together, Mark and Nathan will answer the questions that you've provided. You can continue to do so. As a reminder, just type in those questions in the question box to the right of your screen. And let's get started. First one here, how many states have passed laws to mandate QA programs like Florida did?
Yeah, this is Mark. APCO just did a study. I think that there's probably close to 30 states that have some sort of training statute on the books. Very few have one as comprehensive as Florida does, and I think that's the issue. There's just not enough oversight, there's not enough compliance to make sure that those existing statutes are even followed. But I think at this time there's about 30 or 32 states, something like that.
Gotcha. And what are the best ways for people to support the efforts of your foundation?
I think the best way is to just take this back to your centers and try to spread the word to your, you know, line level dispatchers or as many people that you know that work in this industry so that they can, you know, constantly remember, you know, why they're doing what they're doing and how important their job is and how important, you know, we all think their job is. Like, you know, obviously as a nonprofit foundation, you know, we are always looking for donations on that front, but I think, you know, the economic times are difficult, but I think that on a base level, just being able to just spread the word about what our story is and how every call could be a Denise call. Every call could be a bystander witnessing something in real time, and you have an amazing responsibility to make sure that the information gets, you know, to where it needs to be. So, you know, on that note, I didn't get to say this when I was talking, but nobody appreciates the 911 system more than me. And, you know, I'm not angry. I'm not upset. I just know that this system has a lot of challenges, and I really respect what you do. I could not be a dispatcher or a call taker. I can't believe that I hear some of these stories of people that have done this for 30 years longer, and it's just amazing. So, you know, to everybody listening, I really appreciate what you do.
Another question is the standardization being addressed on a federal level rather than the individual states?
Yeah, we have, I mean, there's been some talks about how we would like to try to push this to a federal level. You know, we've been working with the different 911 associations of trying to, you know, formulate a plan to get to that point. And we've made some pretty good progress with that. I just think that, you know, a lot of states are on the right track, and a lot of states, you know, have training standards in place, but they're just not mandated. And unfortunately, the federal government doesn't like to micromanage the states, and the states don't like being micromanaged by the federal government. So I think it's something that will happen. I do not know how long it will be. We are definitely on the right track for that. But I think as far as people in individual states, I think a great thing to do is figure out what your standard is and figure out if there are training standards at all. And if there is, then find out what they are and how they can be better. If they're not mandatory, how can you make them mandatory? You know, we just went through a process here in Florida that seemed fairly painless, actually. It had its hurdles, but luckily we were able to rally with the people in the industry and make it happen. And we were able to have that public reaction and the public's outrage of making something change and making our system better. So, you know, that's another thing. But we are more than happy to answer on a more specific basis for people around the country of, you know, how we can maybe help or give our advice on how to, you know, get to the next level with that.
Great. It another question popped up. It's amazing that the feds require standards for issuing using the pilot's license, but not the 911 industry.
It is. It's amazing what you know. And then we showed the slide of what states require certification for, and 911's not on that list. I think one of the biggest problems is if you ask 10 random people on the street if 911 operators and dispatchers are certified, I bet you at least 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10 would say yes. And then if you ask the same question, should they be certified, all of them would say yes. But that's not the reality. Public perception isn't reality. You know, we all assume, and I assumed, I was included before this happened, that of course, every 911 worker should be certified. Every telecommunicator should have, you know, a lot of training and be certified. And they deserve to be certified. You know, they deserve to be looked at the same level as police officers and firefighters. They are the true first responders. And it's a shame that they sometimes get overlooked or get trampled on or are always stuck at the bottom of that totem pole. And I know they are in this area. And it's a shame where I live here in Florida. And we're starting to fix that. We're starting to get more recognition for them to show that look how important these people are and look how difficult their job is. And it's really a shame and shocking, but that's part of our mission for the foundation is to raise public awareness and help educate the public on how important 911 is and look at some of the challenges that they're facing.
Great. The next question is, Nathan, do you know what the staffing levels were in the dispatch center that night, and did that have anything to do with the information not being passed on?
I do know the staffing. It was actually two dispatchers, and there were two call takers on call, and one supervisor. And there was actually the one of the call takers was doing both call taking and dispatching for fire, and then the other two dispatchers were all for police. And the staffing levels actually, you know, could have been more. I think most people that are in this industry would say that they could always use more people in the center, especially during times of, you know, a lot of traffic, especially when you're, you know, a search for a missing person. But the biggest issue in this case was procedure not being followed. The call taker had been there for 15 years, who took Jane Kowalski's call, the call that was botched, and she did not enter her information into the CAD system in real time. She wrote it down, supposedly, on a piece of paper and stood up in the room and shouted across the room to the dispatcher to dispatch the call. Well, obviously that's not how it works, and that's not the proper procedure. I'm not a dispatcher, but I'm pretty sure that's not the right procedure. And so basically what happened was one dispatcher thought that the other dispatcher was sending it out, and it never happened. So it's, you know, if the information had been entered into the CAD, it would have popped up on the dispatcher screen to dispatch a new call for service. But what actually ended up happening was the call taker entered the information 12 minutes after the call ended and didn't create a new call for service. She just put it in with the other call, so no prompt came up for anybody to dispatch anything due to that specific call. So it's extremely frustrating. I mean, there was a shift change, but that didn't affect anything because the dispatchers and everybody in that center stayed. They all stayed past and made sure that everything was handled before they left. So it's just really a shame.
Okay. The next question is directed to both of you. Do either of you give lectures at communication centers or other agencies?
Yeah, I try to you know, leave that open as much as I can. I really enjoy. I don't enjoy, you know, putting our pain on display, but I do enjoy the fact that Denise's story is making a difference, and I'm really excited to see that my kids someday are going to see how much their mom was able to make a difference. And I haven't really had an opportunity to get into actual dispatch centers as much as I would like, but we've attended many state conferences. We've been to a bunch of national conferences for NENA and APCO and NAED, but we are definitely I think a dispatch center is the main place I would like to get. I want to be able to speak to everyone, and I want everyone in that center to hear our story. You know, because sometimes at these state conferences, you know, it's just a supervisor or a manager that gets to go. And I think it's really important that everybody gets to hear how important their job is. So yeah, we do. You know, we do would love that if people would like us to come.
Great. Next question is, when you're talking about certification, are you speaking about 911 dispatchers in general for all areas of our jobs, or specifically in the medical calls?
Well, that's a great question, because in Florida, the language in the Florida statute for the E911 fund was very specific. It was only to call taking, and dispatching was not part of that realm that money could be used for. So in our bill this year, we had that language changed to telecommunicator. So that covered every facet of 911, whether you're call taking, dispatching, fire, medical, and different things like that. So, and part of our
you know, that's part of the whole, you know, examining your own state and figuring out what your statutes are and what your training standards are. A lot of E-91 funds are very specific, and some are very broad. But we were able to change that in Florida. So yeah, that telecommunicator is a word that APCO kind of came up with this year for the Florida bill, and that helped solve that problem.
Great. I'm also getting some comments here, just saying that they're a training supervisor. They'd love for you to come and share your story with their center. They're going to contact you further. Again, Nathan's information is here, and you can contact him directly. You can also contact Higher Ground if you have any further questions, and we can try to assist you. And that is really all the questions that I have. If you have any more people, put them in quickly. I'll begin to wrap up, and I just want to, again, thank you, Nathan. I really appreciate you joining us today and sharing your story. I also want to personally thank Cheryl Ornberg of the Northwest Central Dispatch right outside of Chicago for introducing me to Mark and Nathan. It is because of her that we are actually having this webcast today, so I really appreciate it. And I want to thank all of you again for your interest in this topic. And if you have any additional questions or would like additional information, you can contact, as I said, Nathan directly or Higher Ground. And in addition, if you'd like to learn about Higher Ground's dispatch evaluation solution, it's called Quality 911, or would like to view this presentation again or any of the webcasts in our series, you can do so by visiting Higher Ground's website at www.capture911.com. And the webinars can be downloaded on demand, and they're under the Resources tab. I know that today is Veterans Day, so you may want to share this with some other people in your dispatch center who may not be working today. And that wraps up our presentations. I want to thank you again and wish you all a great day.